Hello all, it's J-Mix here, and I'd like all my YouTube subs and viewers to check out AJ Benz's new podcast called Fame is a Bitch. You can check out the first couple episodes if you hit this link right here, which will also be in the description. But I highly encourage you guys to get it on Google Play, get the app, tune in, and listen. For those who want the inside information on some of the most scandalous celebrity events, I think this podcast is going to be for you. So be sure to get it on Google Play and support AJ Benza.
This is a J-Mix exclusive.
When we come back, we're going to talk to RJ Bond at the 9 o'clock hour. This guy knows who killed Tupac Shakur. Everything else you've heard and seen before this interview is baloney. Don't believe it. I know all the books. I know all the movies. They're crap. This one's the real one. I'm very excited about who I'm bringing on next, RJ Bond and Michael Douglas Carlin. I just want to say real quick, AJ Benza, 790 KABC, Friday night special. The number here is 222. Do call in if you have any questions or any theories about, well, forget the theories because you're wrong. I have the real story. And the thing about the Tupac murder and the Biggie murder, it was a lot bigger than just two people getting killed. You know, could you imagine nowadays if John Mayer and Ed Sheeran were rubbed out in the street and the cops never found out who killed them? Are you kidding me? That just wouldn't happen. But a couple of rappers, sure, listen, we can't. We'll work on it, but you never know. But Tupac, look, the media loved him. He got a lot of attention. And then you got a guy like Suge Knight, who was the head of Death Row Records, who was he started to believe himself. There was a book we read in school in the eighth grade called Animal Farm. And the major quote to take away from that book was power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. And that is what happened with Suge Knight. And I think that that's a good lead in with RJ and Michael. You guys there?
We're there. How you doing, man?
Hey, man, what's going on, guys? Thanks for being here.
We're happy to be here.
You know, I wanted to say the reason why I opened up with the absolute power corrupts absolutely is because I think that's what, in essence, happened with Suge Knight. Much like John Gotti kind of put an end to the mafia's old ways, because he loved attention. He loved being flashy. And the real old-time guys didn't like that. I think the real guys in the music business or the guys working in the music business, they didn't want a guy like Suge Knight to get that big. And then, of course, when you mix him with the lightning rod that is Tupac Shakur, someone's gonna get hurt, because there's a lot of money going around that people are laundering, etc. Set the stage, because it's very deep about what happened with Tupac and Suge.
Well, I think that the place that we start looking at the investigation is really what one of the critical failures in the investigation was, and that is the inability to look at the big picture. I think if you get real myopic and you look at them as just two killings, I think you do yourself a disservice. You know, the 1980s and the late 1980s and the early 1990s was just a deluge of drugs, free-flowing money, free-flowing drugs, just more than anybody knew.
It was Clinton. Of course, Clinton got everybody. Listen, I was in the middle of it. Clinton got me. Bill Clinton made me rich. And, there was drugs and alcohol around, and it was party time. Absolutely, you're right.
It was a good time to be had by all. And, of course, whenever there's a lot of money and a lot of drugs, there's a lot of opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
And, we enter the movie and we talk about an operation called Operation Big Spender with the L.A. County Sheriff's Department. And that was a federal investigation on sheriffs that were actually shaking down drug dealers, taking the drugs away and stealing the cash.
Which has happened. That happens all over. But I mean, it was very prevalent where they were. Right.
Absolutely. Yep, absolutely. You were talking about the tune of $60 million that was being stolen cash off these drug dealers.
Jeez.
And, the drug dealers weren't saying much about it. But, of course, the Sheriff's Department, the good guys at the Sheriff's Department asked that the Fed step in. And that kind of led to a big investigation. And, when you've got that kind of corruption or you've got that kind of influence and one guy's getting away with it, word gets out pretty fast.
Yeah.
It's an easy buck easy buck to make. And, you know, Compton being what they call the hub city, you know, it's kind of the center of commerce. They weren't strangers to controversy and corruption anyway.
No.
And, of course, how are you going to pass on an opportunity that's just too good to have?
But I think what people don't realize in this whole scenario, and I'll just say real quickly that, you know, there's been other movies about Tupac and Biggie. There's been books written, many, many articles written. And I've read them all and seen them all, and they just don't do it justice. They like to harp on that angle of the fight at the casino and Orlando Anderson, you know, they're stomping on Orlando, rat packing him, as they call it, and then apparently he's the shooter. Well, it turns out he's not the shooter, but the media wanted us to believe it was caused for that, and it was also caused from Crips vs. Blood, and that's all nonsense, right?
Well, it's easy. I mean, you know, it's a convenient truth. If you want to go to bed at night and not worry about crooked cops or not worry about corruption in law enforcement or city officials, and you want to just believe that a couple of gang guys, you know, shot each other and that's the end of the story, it's pretty, puts a pretty nice bow around it, wouldn't
sure.
you say?
Sure. What people don't know is there was major articles discredited by, what was it, Chuck Phillips, the LA Times?
What's his name? Chuck Phillips. He wrote some really bad information.
Yeah, I mean, talk about fake news. He wrote erroneous articles about this murder. And the thing is, obviously, people got to him too because he said things a certain way. I know what it's like when you get those phone calls, and he's touching on a subject that's pretty dicey and dangerous. But people were led to believe it happened that way. But I want to get down to what people don't understand is how many policemen were around Suge Knight, the owner of Death Row Records. How many policemen were around Tupac in general? And let the folks know how many of them were bodyguards, etc.
Michael, go ahead.
Well, what you had is you had Death Row Records that had a big problem with Snoop Dogg, with his murder trial.
Mm-hmm.
And if Snoop would have had an off-duty cop working for him at the time that Malik shot Philip Waldemariam, you would have never had that scenario happen. And so there was a protocol change inside of Death Row Records where they only used off-duty police as security. And when Tupac came to the record label, it was a big problem because Tupac was hated by the police.
Because of Atlanta,
He had shot two off-duty cops in Atlanta, and so none of the cops wanted to bodyguard him.
Yeah.
And they had Frank Alexander, who was a non-cop, was Tupac's bodyguard. You had Michael Moore, who was a fireman, who was Tupac's bodyguard. But all of the other artists were bodyguarded by LAPD, Inglewood Police, Compton Police, Compton School Police. And so you had all of these off-duty cops working for Death Row Records, and it was an escalating pattern of behavior that happened inside of Death Row Records.
And Michael, how many of those cops died under mysterious circumstances? I'm talking about heart attacks at 42, alleged suicides. Weren't they very prevalent? I remember there were a number of deaths of bodyguards surrounding Tupac and Suge that just didn't smell right.
Go ahead, RJ. Well, there was a lot of Suge had a lot of bodyguards that were his kind of thugs, his hitmen, and they certainly dropped like flies right after the time that Suge went to prison.
Right.
They started dropping like flies, and then of course you had Frank Alexander, much much later, of course, died under mysterious circumstances, and then of course Russell Poole, who basically wrote the book on the Biggie investigation, no matter what anybody else claims, he did it. And he died under mysterious circumstances right there at LA County Sheriff's headquarters.
But here's what I want to set the stage here. So we're in Vegas, we're on the strip, everybody knows it happened on Flamingo Road at a red light. Suge is driving. But that night, there was a call. Reggie Wright Jr., right? Head of security. Bad guy. He's a bad guy. And kind of running the show. But tell the folks how crazy it was when it came to radio, who was carrying radios, who was and wasn't carrying guns that night as bodyguards, and how many checkpoints they had covered.
I mean, listen, if this wasn't something that was just, you know, intentionally done, you've got the Keystone Cops. It was the worst security outfit, you know, ever. You've got, you know, bodyguards were told that night not to carry any weapons. And there was all this talk about, well, they were told because of, you know, permit issues or whatever. You know, Las Vegas is an open carry.
It's open carry. You can carry at Denny's if you want to.
Exactly. So, you know, you've got that. And then on top of that, Frank Alexander, who's the main bodyguard for Tupac Shakur, he goes there and he gets told that he can't have a radio. There's not enough radios to go around. Death Row, it's a $500 million record company. You can't go down to Radio Shack and just buy a radio, for God's sake. So, you know, you've got this whole clown show going on where they're not arming security. And the one guy, Michael Moore, who says he's going to carry his weapon anyway, they take him off of Tupac Shakur and put him over at Club 662 to keep him away from everything. So, you know, you've got this whole thing. You've got the head of security calling people in their rooms, checking to see where they are that night, just making sure they're where they're supposed to be, including their hotel rooms not working. And you've got this whole, like I said, if it wasn't intentional, it would be the worst Keystone Cop farce of a security you'd ever.
But here's the weird thing, and I know I want to get to the great point you make about the confession letter, etc. The movie, of course, is called Tupac Assassination Battle for Compton. And where is it now? It's on iTunes and Amazon, everywhere?
Yeah, it's all over the place. It's Amazon, Google, Play. Okay. You've got iTunes. I mean, if you want it, you can find it. If you got Amazon Prime, you get it for free.
All right, good. You got to see this movie. I'm telling you, it's riveting, and I've seen all of them. But what fascinated me was that, you know, Suge was probably the intended victim that night in the car, right? And he gets hit with a fragment on his skull. But he was the intended victim, you say.
Well, yeah, you've got to take if you take Tupac out of it for a minute. Let's say that somebody drives down the road and they're going to shoot at Tupac and Suge. Let's take Tupac out of the car for a minute. If you're going to be ballsy enough, and it doesn't matter who it is and doesn't matter what your motive is, if you're going to shoot at Tupac, that's one thing. But you're talking about arguably one of the heaviest hitters in the record industry. This guy had power. He had money. He had guns. He could pretty much get whatever he wanted to. And if you're going to be crazy enough to run up on Tupac, you're also shooting at that very man.
Right.
So
right.
You better hit what you're shooting at. I mean, it's a fool to suggest that it was the way they've said it is a fool's errand, because if you're not going to kill both of them, you've got a real problem on your hands.
I just can't believe that they're all they're gangsters and they're shooters, and for God's sake, what, 13, 14 bullets in the car, and they can't hit a 300-pound man like Suge Knight. They hit him with a that's just ridiculous to me that they missed so badly. But what I also don't like is that Suge Knight got on a plane and went back to L.A.
Well, and there's an experience modification that happens between the Tupac murder and the Biggie murder. They hire a professional shooter in the Biggie murder, and they use armor-piercing rounds the next time they do this. And so you can see these guys had an escalating pattern of behavior, and they learned from their mistakes.
Yeah, they definitely knew what they were doing in the second one. We're up against the break. I'm going to bring you back for the second segment because I want to talk about the confession letter. I want to talk about the Patton brothers, which is fascinating. I want people to hear exactly and crystallize it as to say how you think it went down exactly. We're with R.J. Bond and Michael Douglas Carlin. And the movie is Tupac Assassination Battle for Compton. A.J. Benza, KABC. We're back in a minute. I'm with R.J. Bond and Michael Douglas Carlin. This is A.J. Benza on KABC 790. The number here is 22252. You know, there's two points I want to get to. I got 6 minutes, so I want you guys to be as concise as you can. I know it's not easy because this is a big story. But in particular, you've got a confession letter that I want the folks to understand what that's about and who the Patton boys, the Patton brothers are.
All right, Michael, you're concise.
The confession letter is something that was given to Chris Blatchford from Fox 11. It was given to him as an insurance policy, and at one point the Patton brothers wanted to come forward. He actually had conversation with them on the phone, and he was brought in by a man named Robert Soria, who was a confidential informant he had used before.
Right.
And they said that they were in the car the night that Tupac was killed, or he wasn't killed that night, but he was shot, and they said that they wanted to come clean with this because they were afraid they were going to be killed.
And the Patton brothers—they're the real deal. Those are shooters. Those guys get things done.
Yeah, they're fixers. That's what they do.
Fixers, right?
And it's funny. That night, they didn't get things done, and the other person that they said was in the car was Little Half Dead, which happens to be Snoop Dogg's cousin, and on his album cover, he has a image of the slain Tupac Shakur slain Yac Fula on his album cover.
Unbelievable. I saw that. I saw that. And then there was some issue with the song Brenda Got a Baby that Little Half Dead said he had written that years earlier or something like that, right?
Yeah, let's talk about that for a quick second, AJ. The confession letter talks about the problem with demo stealing and that, you know, it was happening pretty rampantly.
Sure.
Rappers would steal each other's demos. And in there, it also mentions that Little Half Dead may have given a demo to Tupac, and Little Half Dead believed that Tupac had stolen a demo of his that ended up somehow being part of Brenda's Got a Baby.
Mm.
And, you know, the big thing, everybody, you know, that's heard that, they laugh it off because many people know that Tupac wrote Brenda's Got a Baby.
Yeah,
I don't think there's anybody that disputes that.
Right.
And so it immediately gets laughed off. Well, that just can't be true. But, you know, you have to look at it and understand that, you know, if Little Half Dead just thought that he got ripped off, I mean, how many people do you know that like to take claim for somebody else's work?
Sure.
Didn't. Either way, it doesn't make each fact, you know, mutually exclusive.
Yeah.
You've got, you know, Tupac, no doubt, wrote Little Brenda's Got a Baby.
Mm-hmm.
But that doesn't mean the Little Half Dead didn't feel somehow that he had been slighted.
And if you feel slighted, that's reason enough to go off and do what you want to do anyhow. You don't need anything more than that.
Absolutely. Yeah, you don't need anything. That's right. Entire civilizations have gone to war over false assumptions. Mm-hmm. You know, what can you say?
Yeah, and you know, what's fascinating about the movie, Tupac Assassination, Battle for Compton, Reggie Wright Jr. is mentioned a lot. And real quick, I want the folks to know basically what his gig was and why he was as dirty as he was.
Michael?
Well, Reggie Wright Jr. originally worked as a jailer for the Compton jails, and he was known to rip off the inmates that were in the jail.
Mm-hmm.
And then he was known to run the drug trade in Compton, and he and his partner were known to rip off drug dealers. And so there's this pattern of theft, and, you know, we go back to the escalating pattern of behavior. Well, now all of a sudden he has the ability to topple Suge Knight and to take over Death Row Records, and that's exactly what happens.
The ending is really fantastic. The whole movie's fantastic. There's even something in there. We don't have time to get into it now. Maybe just real quickly, I love the story about the helicopter going from L.A. To Las Vegas, Nevada. If you can say that story in a minute, let the folks know, because that's great.
Yeah, well, you know, the what we found out, and this came as a late development in doing the movie, it slowed us down, actually, but we found out that there was a no-bid contract that was awarded to the city of Las Vegas from the city of Compton, and this contract was for the purchase, no-bid purchase on a helicopter that was worth about $1 million.
Yeah.
And here you've got the city of Compton with an $11 million budget and the city of Las Vegas with $500 million budget. Yeah. And yet you're selling $1 million helicopter to the city of Las Vegas from Compton for pennies on the dollar.
And principally because Las Vegas, Nevada's PD kind of had they knew where this was going. They were getting hip to what this murder was all about and who might have done it. Correct.
Well, yeah, they kept beating. I mean, they were trying it the other way. They kept trying to push the Orlando Anderson theory on Vegas PD. They kept trying to pony up and put things in front of Vegas PD. Will you buy it? Will you buy it? Will you buy it? They weren't buying it.
They were smart.
We went the other way.
They got it.
They went the other way. If I can't, you know, it's the carrot or the stick. They tried the stick. That didn't work. So now they're going to try the carrot. Let's do something nice for you. Let's give you this helicopter, which you can burn up on the launch pad and get some insurance money out of it. You know, I mean, it's so many mob tactics that you see. You know, AJ, you and I are a couple of Goombas here. Yeah. You know, we know mob tactics.
Yeah.
And, you know, it doesn't take much to see that this isn't really all that significant. It's kind of garden variety.
Of course. And you know what? Tupac liked me because, as he said, I was Italian, and he liked hanging around with Italians. I actually took him to Brooklyn a couple of times to see some tough guys. He loved that. But listen, anybody who's got anything to do or nothing to do this weekend, get the movie, Tupac Assassination, Battle for Compton. It's personal for me because I knew the guy, and you guys did a great job. I can't wait to see what you do next. RJ Bond and Michael Douglas Carl. I forget. It's like because you have three first names in your name. That's why it's confusing. You could be anybody. Michael Douglas Carl and RJ Bond. Guys, thanks for calling in. You did a great job in the film, and I'll talk to you down the road.
AJ, thanks, man. Take care, buddy.
Thank you so much. Have a great night.
We're back in a minute.